Hi, and welcome to the very first webinar of the Open Charge Alliance. It's my honor to present the first one with Lonneke Driessen. She will be doing her presentation on the Open Charge Alliance and OCPP in general. I will take questions through the question box you can see in your GoToWebinar desk. She will be giving a presentation for about 20 minutes, and afterwards she will be answering questions. We hope to answer all the questions, but we have a rather large crowd, so we will try to do it as best as we can. Thank you for your patience, and now I will give the word to Lonneke.
Thank you, Martijn. So welcome everybody to the first of a series of webinars that we are organizing today and tomorrow. Today and tomorrow we also have the OCPP Plugfest, and we thought for this edition it would be a nice idea to in parallel also organize webinars that everybody can watch while working wherever you are, probably from home. So this is the first presentation. It will last around 30 minutes. And I wanted to introduce to you the Open Charge Alliance. The short for Open Charge Alliance is OCA, and we are an industry alliance that is governing the protocol OCPP. So as you may know, the OCPP is an acronym for Open Charge Point Protocol, and it's the communication protocol between a backend system and a charging station. We developed OCPP over the past decade, and every time we incorporated the need of the industry, but also field experience. Charging stations have been operational with OCPP for 10 years now. And of course, everybody is learning a lot, things that can be improved and need to be added. And all those learnings we have incorporated in OCPP in the subsequent versions. It's important to know that OCPP is open. You can download it, you can use it. There are no license fees, there is no IP in it. So everybody can use it in whatever way they like. The name OCPP, however, is trademarked, so there is only one OCPP, and the protocol itself is copyrighted by the Open Charge Alliance, so not another party can issue another version of OCPP. So OCPP is protected through the Open Charge Alliance, and you can use it in whatever way you like. So why have we started developing an open standard where there are no license costs or barriers for adoption? So this is something that we believe in. There are other people who might not believe in this, but we do. So we think that if you develop an open standard, it's a better standard because everybody can contribute, share their learnings, improve upon, discuss about improvements. And since everybody can be included, it gets more support. We think that open standards are good for competition because if you have an open system, you can keep selecting companies as you go and keep companies competitive. So we think that they are beneficial for competition. And lastly, we also think that open standards in general are good for innovation because it's not the regular companies who develop the standards, but anybody can join, new entrants, startups, companies from other industries, and they bring new ideas and solutions. So we think that that helps the innovation, and that's something that we need since the industry is in a very early stage. So the benefit if you are a vendor is and you are running a network or you are operating a network, the benefit is that you can select the charging stations as you go. So nobody installs a network all in once. Everybody sort of does it gradually during a few years or even more. And of course, things change and needs to change. So when you use OCPP, you can buy a first batch from vendor A and B. And as you develop new markets, you can buy a second and third batch from C, D. So you can keep mixing your providers of the charging stations inside your network. The same goes, of course, the benefit goes from when you are a charging station manufacturer or developer. If you have developed a product using a standard, and in this case, OCPP, you can join multiple networks. So you can join in one continent, one network, and another continent, another network. So it also makes you flexible for different markets. And of course, it should reduce your development cost because part of your development has already been done for previous assignments. So the OCPP part should be, you should be able to recycle that. So that should save you some time and investments. So now a bit about the history of OCPP. When did it start? So it was initiated in 2009, so more than 10 years ago, by a company called Elat.nl. And Elat.nl is a company founded by the Dutch distribution system operators and the transport system operators, so the grid operators. And back in 2009, they wanted to develop a multi-vendor charging network. And back in those days, Elat asked the market, and it was a very early market, but they asked the market if they could provide a standard, and there was none. So what do you do if you want a standard and there is none? Well, you just start with something yourself. So basically, Elat started with only a few messages, basically start charging, stop charging, and get meter values. And Elat just started implementing that and working together with the multiple vendors to develop it. And that's sort of how it started. Elat is also a non-profit organization. Elat is a knowledge and innovation center. And at the moment, Elat is mainly focusing on the integration of electric vehicles into the power grid. So if you look at the timeline, as I mentioned, in 2009, Elat started itself and started the first versions of OCPP. And 1 year later, the first more public version was published, the OCPP 1.2, followed in 2012 by OCPP 1.5. So you may know that there are still charging stations out there using 1.5, and some vendors are even still offering OCPP 1.5 charging infrastructure, but it's basically already 8 years old. So in 2014, Elat thought that while a lot of companies were contributing to OCPP, it would be better to sort of transfer OCPP to a central organization. So that's why the Open Charge Alliance was founded back in 2014. And yeah, Elat transferred OCPP to this Open Charge Alliance. So 3 years after OCPP 1.5, OCPP 1.6 was published. And as you may know, it is the most widely used version at the moment. So most vendors have 1.6 or offering 1.6, but this was published 5 years ago. So what we developed as an Open Charge Alliance 1 year later is a test tool that you can purchase, and you can test your OCPP 1.6 messages to see if they are exactly according to the spec. And later today, we have a separate webinar explaining more about this test tool. 2 years ago, 2018, we published OCPP 2.0, which is again a newer version of the protocol with more functionalities and some improvements. Last year, the Open Charge Alliance set up the OCPP certification program. That means that if you have a system running on 1.6, you can get a OCPP certificate from an independent test lab. And also today, there is another webinar about the certification program. And a few weeks ago, we published the errata release, or the bug fix release of OCPP 2.0, and we call that one OCPP 2.0.1. So if you are getting started at this moment with OCPP 2, you should use the 2.0.1. That's the version to use at the moment. And for next year, we are working on a testing tool also for OCPP 2.0.1. All this information and much more information you can find on the OCA website. You can see in the header what the address is. As I mentioned, it is a non-profit organization, a Dutch foundation founded in 2014, and it's a member organization, so you can join if you like. And at the moment, we have 166 members. This is sort of an overview of who is a member. If you look to the gray graph to the left, you see that there are many people who are using OCPP, so they are not members, but they are using it. And we don't keep track at the Open Charge Alliance, so we don't really know who is using it. The one thing that we keep track of is the number of downloads the protocol gets. So how many times does the protocol get downloaded from the website? That's the only thing we keep track of. So what we know, the data up until last week, is that OCPP is downloaded to 148 countries. So in a lot of countries, people are downloading OCPP. And we are logging the individual IP addresses, and it's by now more than 65,000. So what we know is that at least a lot of people know about it and have read it. Of course, we don't know if they are actually implementing it, but this is a first good sign. to the pie charts to the top right, you see the continents where OCPP is being downloaded to, Europe, Asia, Africa. Well, you see every continent is represented. And I will explain it a bit more later. If you are not a member, you can still use it, so no problem. But you can also decide to join the Open Charge Alliance, and we have at the moment 166 members. And two-thirds or the large part comes from Europe, but we also have significant representation from Asia and North America. And we see the first few members from South America and Australia, New Zealand, and even from Africa joining the Open Charge Alliance. To the pie chart to the right, you see, bottom right, you see what type of companies are OCM members. So you see that there are a few OEMs, a few utility companies, consultancy and research groups, but the main bulk of the members are really from the EV charging industry. So they either are operating networks or developing software for networks, or they're making charging stations or components for charging. So the largest group of OCM members is coming from the specific EV charging industry. So we are very focused. But of course, not all the members are really active in developing the protocol. That is sort of a subset of the members. And up until now, we think that more or less 34 companies actively developed the protocol, gave their input, and helped improve the specification based on their knowledge of markets and field experience. So very briefly, an overview of the different versions. The 1.5 version from 2012 only used the transport mechanism SOAP. If you look at the one from 2015, 1.6, you can use either SOAP or JSON, whatever you prefer. This is a sort of a rough indication of what's added to 1.6 compared to 1.5. Basically, we've added smart charging, remote trigger, and also the white paper on OCPP 1.6 security. The 2.0 version only supports JSON, so no longer SOAP, because it was too verbose by the judgment of the industry. So it only supports JSON. And here you see that there is a lot of improvements regarding 1.6, but there are also a few new things. The whole display of messages on the charging station, also the displaying and sending of tariffs and costs is added, which is not part of OCPP 1.6. And lastly, we have included everything that you need to have in OCPP if you want to run ISO 15118, which is another protocol from a charging station to an electric vehicle. So OCPP versions are not backwards compatible. So if you have a charging station 1.5, 1.6, 2.0, your back office has to have all these different versions implemented. But you can do a remote upgrade, and that's something that some companies do if you have a charging station still running on 1.5. And if the vendor supports 1.6 on that hardware, and if the platform supports it, you can upgrade your charging stations, and then you can reduce the number of protocols that your system is supporting. But this, of course, depends on the hardware vendor, if they support newer versions on older platforms, and if they the platforms itself are capable of running a bigger version of the spec. So if you want to explore this, you should check with your vendors if they can do this. But this is the way that some companies handle the multiple versions. So the Open Charge Alliance, basically we have three activities. First of all, the most important one is the development of the OCPP protocol. So of course we are still working on this, and slide later I will show you what we are working on at the moment for the future versions of OCPP. So this is the biggest part, and also the most money is spent by the Open Charge Alliance on editing, technical editing of the specification. The second activity is the compliance testing and certification, so the development of test tools so you can check if your version is according to the precise specification, and also certification program, which basically means that there are independent test labs where you can go with your implementation. They will test in your implementation if it's a proper OCPP, and then you get a certificate, and you can use that certificate in your marketing or to help in the sales of your product. And the third part is, of course, we promote OCPP today with this webinar, but we, of course, we also have a website. But what we also regularly do, and this is what we are doing today and tomorrow as well, is we organize Plugfest, where companies can test their implementations against each other. We have PlugFest of 1.6 and 2.0. Usually we have a 50-50 split, people who are on site, who are testing in person, and 50% tests remotely, because you can do that if you're running a charging station with a network. And of course, given the current situation with Corona, this PlugFest is fully remote. So everybody is testing online, and we are very happy that at least we can continue to some extent with the PlugFest in this way. So the OCA organization, we have a sort of a board, an Open Charge Alliance board. The five companies who are currently serving on the board are listed here. They are ESB, and they are a utility from Ireland. ELAD-NL, which is, as I said, an association by the Dutch network operators. GreenLots, they are a charging network solutions provider in the United States. G2 Mobility, they are also a charging solutions provider, and they originate from France. And Innogy, they are a German utility. So we have some administration support, and we have, as I mentioned, three groups, the technology working group. And if you join the Open Charge Alliance, you can join all these groups. And currently the technology working group is focusing on 1.6, because we are still issuing errata sheets for 1.6. Also OCPP 2.0.1, and there is another protocol which is less prominent than OCPP. It is OSCP, Open Smart Charging Protocol, and that's more a protocol for demand response. But those are the protocols you can participate in developing while joining the technology working group. And in addition to that, there are several sub-task groups that are sort of temporary, and there is one important group at the moment, V2X, or vehicle to grid, or bidirectional power flow. That's an important addition, because the bidirectional power flow at the moment is not part of 2.0.1. So we are adding that for the next version, because there is a lot of industry demand for V2X support. The compliancy working group, they're working on the test tool of 1.6, 2.0.0, and the design of the certification program. And of course, there's the promotional working group. So as I mentioned, you can use OCPP even if you're not a member. That's perfectly fine. But why would you become an OCM member? Well, mainly for three reasons. So as I mentioned, you can use OCPP, but if you want to contribute to the development, so if you want to give your input, you have to be a member. The reason for that is the IP policy. So there is no IP in OCPP. So if you want to input something in it, you have to be a member, because if you join, you sign off your IP. You say, if I have any IP, I will never charge any money for it. And it's really important. If you want to contribute due to the IP policy, you have to be a member. The same thing goes for the compliance test tool and the certification program. Anybody can get the tool, and anybody can get a certificate. So you don't have to be a member for that purpose as well. But if you are a member, you can contribute to the development of the testing and certification program. So you can influence the shape the certification program gets. And lastly, regarding promotion, the PlugFest, the webinars, everything, you can also join if you're not a member. But, and this is important, if you are a member, you contribute a little bit of money to the Open Charge Alliance, and by your funding, that allows the Open Charge Alliance to do all these things. So we would really appreciate it if you could become a member, because then you help a good cause. This is what I mentioned previously, the PlugFest. So please, if you are working on an implementation, either 1.6 or 2.0.1, keep an eye out for this PlugFest and sign up. What we do is round robin testing with other companies. If you have a charging station or a charging station management system, you can join. As I mentioned, in person or remote at the moment, for now it's just remote. And currently there is the PlugFest for 2.0.1 today and tomorrow ongoing. And we plan the next PlugFest for 1.6 in July. So if you look at the development roadmap of OCPP, there are several OCPP versions out there, and you can still use all of them. And more or less every 3 years, a new version of OCPP is published. At the moment, the most prominent version is 1.6, and OCPP 2.0 is starting. I mentioned that we are still improving on OSBP 2.0.1, and what we are adding at the moment is the bidirectional power flow. It could be that at some point in the future, we will need to add stuff for the newer version of ISO 15118, but that version is not yet finalized. Some say it's at the end of this year, but as soon as we are aware of the latest version of 15118, we'll check and see if there is anything needed in OCPP to accommodate that protocol. And we are also starting work with the Shanamo organization, because of course many charging stations also support Shanamo, and it could be that in that collaborative work that we are starting with the Shanamo organization, there are some additions needed, not only for the Shanamo 1.1, but also for maybe for the newer version 2.0, but we'll see. And of course, anything else the industry needs. So if there are demands from the industry, certain features of certain functionalities, we'll add them to OCPP as we have always done over the past decade. So this is our slogan. Are you talking to me? Talk OCPP. We have these t-shirts, and if you join the Plugfest, you get a t-shirt under the condition that you wear it. And I'd like to conclude, you, please become a member. You don't have to become a member, but it would be really great if you would. And with that, I would want like to hand over to Martijn.
Thank you, Lonneke. Let's see, we have some questions. I will see what goes best. We have some technical questions, but I think we can save that for later webinars. I have a question by Zara Batti, and she asked, in the viewpoint of an EV driver, what is the benefit of using a charge station with OCPP implemented? And is it possible for an EV driver to override a charge limit placed on a charge point?
Okay, so the first question, what is the benefit if you're an EV driver? Well, if you are already an EV driver and you use a system where you have an RFID card, you may have noticed that in some charging stations, there is a very strict sequence. So first you have to plug in, and then you have to swipe your card, and then you have to plug into your vehicle, or the other way around. And the good thing is if you have a proper station with OCPP, that really doesn't matter. So that is one small example where you just, any sequence that you choose, you can, the charging station just starts charging. That is a very small example of how a EV driver can actually notice that a charging station has implemented the protocol properly. But besides that, the main benefit from for an EV driver is, if you have a very active market, if you have a lot of charging station providers, that and everybody uses OCPP and an open standard, the market will become more innovative and more competitive, and that could result in more charging stations being out there and better charging stations. So basically, an open market, having an open market, should lead to a better market, and that should in turn help EV drivers. Of course, the main benefit is between vendors, so manufacturers of equipment. So not as much for EV drivers, but indirectly we do see a real benefit. The second question is about whether if you're an EV driver, and there is, I assume that the question is about demand response on the charging station. The whole design of how that demand response program is applied to the charging station depends on the implementation. The one thing that OCPP contributes to is that anything that someone can design gets implemented, but OCPP in itself doesn't decide those rules. So what OCPP does is you forward charging profiles and you send a signal, so that OCPP describes the actual messages. But the business rules is decided by the specific implementation. So that's not something that OCPP describes, it's just something that OCPP facilitates. I hope that answers your question.
And I have another question from Ethan Arnold. Let's see. I've implemented my own charging network. How do I allow other networks' customers to use mine? by roaming, and how can I allow my customers to roam in other networks?
Okay, that's a very good question and very important. So the protocol OCPP concerns the information exchange between a charging station and a back office, a central system. If you have your own network and you would like another customer from another network connect to your network, then you are talking about information exchange between networks. For those that type of information exchange, there is another protocol, which is, for instance, there are many protocols, but one protocol that's very widely known is OCPI. And I do recognize that all these slightly different acronyms might be a bit confusing, but OCPI stands for Open Charge Point Interface. And it's also open and royalty free, so it's very similar to OCPP, but it's a different protocol and it handles the information exchange that you would need for roaming. So if you are more interested in that, so how can I connect my network with other networks, I suggest you visit the website of the NKL, nklnederland.nl, and there you can find more information about that protocol. OCPP is a protocol inside the infrastructure, so it can help in exchanging messages, but for your purpose, the protocol you're looking for is OCPI.
Okay. Let's see. I have a question by Chitrak Chandak. He asks, if I am only developing a mobile application, how can I access third-party chargers? And does OCPP allow me to do so?
I think that question is similar. If you have a mobile app, that means that you would want to connect to a central system. So not directly to a charging station, and I think that is the same information exchange and it's not in scope of OCPP, but you should look more towards exchange with other networks with using a protocol, for instance, as OCPI.
Okay. Let's see. I have a question from Sung Chu Choi. Should the charger station be able to communicate with multiple vendors, operators simultaneously?
Oh, no. We have the architecture that you can also see in the OCPP documentation is that one charging station speaks with one central system. Because that's the relation that is in place. So there's one central system managing one individual charging stations. You can, of course, migrate, and that's something that we've done in the past number of times. So if at one moment in time a charging station is communicating with one network, and for some reason the network is changed or the charging stations are sold to another network operator, you can migrate, and OCPP facilitates that. So you can migrate your charging station from one system to another system. But at one moment in time, there is only one management system managing the charging station.
Okay. We don't have much time left. Let's see for an interesting last question. Public transport is transforming from diesel to electric buses, says Mr. Schut. How can the OCA support the public transport industry?
Yes, that's a very good question. So OCPP basically works on any application of a charging station. So whether it's a wall box at home or a public charger at a parking lot, a DC fast charger along the highway, or charging depots where you are charging electric buses, OCPP works just the same. What we do incorporate is the since this whole public transport electrification is developing very rapidly, we have a lot of members who are contributing their needs. For instance, one of the contributing improvements that we've had for the 2.0.1 version was a better device model. It's a bit technical, but it allows, if you have more complex charging networks, charging stations or maybe some energy storage on site, that you have more information exchange possibilities in the protocol. So that's what we've done with OCPP 2.0.1. Another important addition is the increasing number of the higher number of charging power. So from 50 kilowatts to 150 kilowatts to 350 kilowatts to even 900 kilowatts or above. So those developments, companies who are using charging infrastructure are already using OCPP. And whenever they find something is missing and needs to be improved, they join and they contact us and we improve the protocol based on that. So in principle, OCPP can handle public transport just as well as any other charging station, but there are some specific things that we learn while implementing electrification of transportation that are very welcome as an addition and that we are incorporated in the future versions of OCPP.
Thank you very much. It is 30 minutes, 31 minutes, so we are almost over time. Thank you very much, everyone attending. Thank you, Lonneke, for your information. There are still some questions open. We are trying to answer them by using the email. We have gathered them, and if you have any questions, please visit us at www.opencharge.org. And you can email us all your questions. We are closing this session for now. I hope you enjoy the other webinars and we hope to be seeing you soon. Thank you.